We'd like to welcome Martine Algier to the Haydash Oral Video History Project. Welcome, Martine.
Thank you.
There's so much, in so many places I can go with your life and your contributions to this era, as well as to many other issues in the world, including peace. I want to start from your very beginnings. Where were you born?
Michigan, Owosso, Michigan.
Okay, and what were your parents' names?
Mary Louise and Richard.
What kind of work did they do?
My father was a journalist and photographer, and my mother, a homemaker, very much involved in being a mother and her church work, healing work.
What brought you to California, and when did this happen?
Well, the first time, I had my parents had moved to Salt Lake City, and when I knew I was going to visit them in Salt Lake City, I thought, I don't know anybody there. What am I going to do and be stuck with my parents the whole time? That is it. So I was involved in Detroit with the artist workshop and a lot of poets, and someone said, oh, well, there's a magazine called Wild Dog Poetry Magazine, and a couple of guys in Salt Lake that published that. Here's their address, and when you get to Salt Lake, you can look them up. So they didn't have a phone. I sent them a card, and they right away showed up, and I proceeded to spend a lot of time with them. And at one point, they said, hey, we're going to San Francisco. This was winter vacations. It was a school break. I'd come to see my parents. And so I said, sure, go to San Francisco. That sounds exciting. Well, drove over the mountain to San Francisco, and what was happening was some amazing convergence of poets, and I very soon found myself sitting with my heroes, because as a high school girl, about 16, I had discovered Allen Ginsberg and Ferlinghetti and Jack Kerouac, and suddenly, Kerouac wasn't there, but all the rest of them, I was in a milieu, I mean, sitting with these people who were my heroes, and this was just a little three-day trip, but it was a very big change in my life because I made connections at that point. I went back to my parents and then I went back to Detroit to finish the term at school. And in June, John Sinclair, there were six of us, and there was a move to go to Berkeley to the big poetry conference. And so I said, okay, I'm on board. And we all just jumped in the car. And I knew I was never going back. I knew that for me.
Approximately what year was this?
64. And we just had one of those wild cross-country rides that a lot of people had in those days.
Sure, sure.
And arrived on the campus of Berkeley, and one of the first people that I saw who came walking up to me was Gary Snyder, who I'd met and fallen in love with on that trip during the winter. Mm-hmm. And so we reconnected, and then next thing I knew, I was in a Volkswagen bus with Allen Ginsberg and Gary Snyder going on this long trip, and just things just unfolded very, very
naturally. Sure, the way they did in those days.
Yeah.
You have a photo of yourself.
This was just before we left for San Francisco.
Great.
This was my partner at the time, Robin Eichley, George Tisch, somewhere over here, was a prominent poet, I hear, in Detroit, and
yourself right there.
And that's moi.
Totally mod.
Oh.
Beautiful. Right. So there you are in Berkeley, and you're not coming back home anymore.
I knew I didn't want to go back to Michigan, no.
I was
staying in the Haight-Ashbury. The place that I landed was the Haight-Ashbury. We had gone over to the campus for the poetry meeting.
Do you know where that was in the Haight-Ashbury?
Yes, it was on Downey Street.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. And
right above, two blocks above Haight.
And so this is about what year in the Haight-Ashbury? Around 64, 65?
65, by the time I came back. It was very quiet. Wasn't a lot happening. It's a nice family neighborhood.
And then it started building. You are known for some of your artwork. Were you already painting? And what is your medium? What do you paint?
I haven't been painting very much lately, but when I was painting, I did oils and pencils. At that time, I wasn't doing much art. I had come to California really to be an actress. I was in acting, I was in theater, I had done film and theater, and that's why I came out. And that was my intention in coming out. Then I got hooked up with all these poetry people and went off on a
whole... Did you write yourself? Start writing it?
I've always written, but and I've had a couple things published, but that's not... never been a main part of my expression.
Yes.
But then I began painting more intensely later.
When you were in the Haight-Ashbury and things started changing, they started to... more flux of people coming from all over. Did you also catch this feeling that everybody seemed to have as a mass?
It was an incredibly exhilarating feeling. But you know, before that happened, I was swept off to Big Sur. Something, there was a whole confluence of energy and...
there's a lot going on in Big Sur at that time.
And when I arrived there for the weekend, I had this experience of going to a party. It was like the ugly duckling meets the swans. I suddenly looked around and I said, oh, I'm one of these. I belong with these people. It was the first time I had ever, and they were in long dresses and long hair and babies at the breasts and men in beards. And there was a sense of, oh, yes, I'm with the people that are my tribe.
Right.
Went back to San Francisco, quit my job, and went back and lived there. And so... while Haight-Ashbury was just starting to foment, so to speak, I was down there mostly at Esalen. At Esalen, quite a bit, which was the beginning of the human potential movement. Fritz Perls was there, Virginia Satir coming, going. All the luminaries of the human potential movement were coming and going from there. So it was a really exciting time.
It was a connection between Esalen and the Haight.
Yes,
connecting Topanga Canyon, the Big Sur, many writers and painters and spiritual thinkers were coming out of that area.
And I think that influence was pretty major in my life. And then it was in the fall of 66 when my little family, I lived in several places in Big Sur, but as winter started coming on, the family scene that I lived with, we were living outside in the canyon, broke apart, and suddenly I was faced with a winter and no one was... there, and I was unsure what to do, and someone I had met in the Haight-Ashbury called and said, I want you to come back and be with me. And so I thought, well, I have nothing else planned, so I'm going to do that. And so when I arrived in the Haight, that was in the fall of 66, and things were really, really cooking. In fact, the night that I arrived, there had been a big National Guard event on the street that day.
Was it one of the where the flatbed truck arrived and music playing and streets are mobbed and then the police come in with their billy clubs?
Right. I wasn't there for that. I came right after.
Boosted. Yeah. They had the straight theater, luckily, on Cole and Haight, and the people who survived are the ones that ran in the theater for cover.
Yeah.
And the day began. So how did your days evolve from there on?
Well, it was so magical. It was so magical. Our apartment was the center of a lot of what was happening.
Where was that?
That was at 1371 Haight Street. And
do you remember the cross streets?
Right by Masonic.
Right
by Masonic. We used to run around the corner to the apartment where the Grateful Dead lived.
Right, 14 Ashbury.
Visit there. And up and down the street. I'd go from our place down Haight Street through the park over to the 9th Street... health food store, which is probably the only natural food store in San Francisco at the time. Buy a bunch of brown rice and whatever I could afford, and then come back through the park, stop at the drum circle, dance for a while in the park, come back, put the rice on, get the soup going, a lot of people coming and going and eating, and meetings. We had a little meditation room. We had a lot of meetings in the meditation room. That was the site of many interesting plans. The Pentagon demonstration was, the idea for that was birthed right there in our meditation room in a little circle.
You have some photos of yourself during the 60s period. I'd love to document some of those and take a moment to find them.
Well, this is an article that came out in Playboy magazine, actually. And that was me down in Big Sur at the at the pool.
It's a beautiful shot.
I used to go and bathe there every morning when I was
a full
can.
Great.
And let's see, this is the, there's a lot of stuff in this article. Where was the Newsweek thing? Where was the Newsweek? Oh, this was, I was way into chanting. It was Hare Krishna was just starting there. We met Bhaktivedanta when he first came to Haight-Ashbury, and I used to love to chant. Allen Ginsberg taught me my first chants, and when we were traveling around the Volkswagen bus. So then I had my finger symbols. I used to love chanting. So this is in the meditation room at the Haight Street place, sitting chanting.
So this is where you lived.
Yes.
And all around you, all this was happening.
All this was
and
happening.
In your home, I mean, there were meetings, there were beginnings, there were... people were inspired by their art, their writing, or
mm-hmm.
wanting to have a vision to do something new. And
there's Jerry Garcia. There.
Yes.
Big pan over here.
That's a great shot.
Yeah.
That's a great shot.
This is a shot from The Human Being, actually. This
67.
Mm-hmm. I was out there dancing barefoot in the park.
Exactly, so was I. Beautiful. At this point in your heart, what was driving you? We have a CD right there.
Oh, it's actually an old 45.
Sure. What is it up?
It's my mother put together these albums as she did for all of her children, and this is Happy Trails to You by Roy Rogers.
Amazing. You have this great shot
you.
That your mother just sent you of what a room should look like, I think, from a magazine.
Oh, it was good housekeeping, but she sent it to me because there's a picture of me on the wall that was taken by Jean Anthony, who did a lot of photography.
I'd love to see that.
Yeah, where's the good hunt? Here it is. Let's see. I'll show you the photograph.
Sure.
If I can find it. This is there's Gene Anthony, and he did this photograph of me in Stinson Beach. I was pregnant with my first child. It was just a sort of a wistful little
it's beautiful.
Thing. And then my mother was looking at good housekeeping, and she looked at the wall here in the picture, and she suddenly said, "Oh, gee, that's a familiar picture." And there it is.
In the shot. Has, amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah. What are your children's names?
Ramakrishna Star and Maitreya Lalila. And have a stepson, Michael Alexander.
Wonderful. So did you get bitten by this bug of peace, everybody hoping for, hey, we can all do it now together, we can change the world? Did
I
you
absolutely
have this feeling?
Sincerely believe that, along with a lot of other really idealistic and wide-eyed young people, and I still do. I realize it's going to take a tiny bit longer than we thought.
Right.
It's not going to just flip over that.
Sure.
But
you think
a lot
we've
more work.
Put some of the ground rules down, laid some of the beginning foundations
of
change?
We had the basic vision. We didn't understand how to do it.
Right.
People going back to the land and trying to live in communities, and we didn't know how to grow carrots and make healthy disposal systems for human
right.
waste. But all that's been worked out. And
sure.
Now, if you look at the Guide to Intentional Communities, you see hundreds and hundreds of communities, thousands of them, all over the world. Very thriving communities. So,
sure.
And people say, oh, too bad the 60s, you know, came and went. And I say, no, not at all. In fact, I brought a picture that is me in a ceremony in Bolinas, one of the annual ceremonies called the Sun Festival. And to me, this really shows how that energy has continued. This
sure.
celebrational energy that involves art and theater and creating unity and and ecstatic, celebrational, transformational energy.
Sure.
This is me in the center doing an opening, which is called the Universal Greeting. It has to do with uniting everybody.
Sure.
We still very much believe that we can create a culture of peace, and the main focus of my work right now as a trainer for the Center for Nonviolent Communication is in creating the foundation for people to be able to live together in peace.
Has to do anything with communication?
Yes.
Communicating and understanding?
Yes. It's a lot to do with the language of what we have been, what we inherited is a mindset, a certain consciousness that's embedded in the language. And what CNBC, Nonviolent Communication, is doing is helping people to have alternatives to that domination-based language, to be able to become aware of how the domination thinking is embedded in the way we speak and have some different choices.
How do people find out more information about that? Do they have a website?
Go to cnvc.org and you'll see what's going on all over the world. We're in more than 30 countries, so it's a very big and lively organization. And locally in the Bay Area, there's a baynvc.org, and there's just wonderful things going on all over the world. It's very exciting.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
If you could tell the young people of the future one, two, or three good things on how they can start to take hold of their lives and the direction of their lives and be inspired by some of what you learned through this path, what would you tell them? If somebody was watching this video 50 years from now.
50 years from now?
Yes.
Oh, I hope that they'll know a lot more than any of us do by then. I would hope they would be.
Where could someone start? You know, who's never even had the thought, well, maybe I could help make peace on this earth. Where?
Well, I think it starts with ourselves, being kind to ourselves, because we first must be kind to ourselves. We're going to be able to be kind to others. And
sure.
It's basic kindness. Basic kindness. And, you know, I think the Dalai Lama wraps it up pretty well in the teachings of the Buddha. Basic kindness.
Exactly.
And getting away from dualistic thinking and separation thinking. We used to say so much about how we are all one, that realization that came through with the use of psychedelics, that we are one, that it is one being. And I think that's still the big key, is recognizing, you know, as long as I can hold your needs as dearly as I hold my own needs, and we can find a way to meet all of our needs.
Exactly.
That there is enough, that there's enough, that there is a way for us to live together peacefully.
I'd love to see some of your artwork. Maybe you could explain it a little bit, what inspired you to create it.
You know, there was a period when things just, it seemed that I was channeling things. I never knew what was going to come out on the paper. I would just set the paper down and then start moving my hand, and a series of portraits came out, which I relate to as spirit guides. This I call the Aquarian Guide. And
beautiful. Is this watercolor oil?
This is oil.
Wow. Beautiful.
And you can see the head is sort of exploding with planets. The third eye is lighting up here. So it's that vision of the human, the new human, the being that I believe is being birthed right now, that is aware and has that single vision. And,
bigger than himself.
Yes. Yeah. Vision of the unity. This is... goes this way. Kind of a person who's looking toward the vision of the future. You see the pyramids and the temple, kind of looking off into the distance of what might be. These idealized cities came up in my paintings quite a bit. And you know, now they really are coming to pass. We have a huge international eco-village movement. I read recently a man has now been hired to do 7 cities in China. They're going to house 400 million people, and everything in them will be completely sustainable.
Wow.
Working on the basis that everything will be not just recycled, but will the waste products from any given thing
sure.
will
contribute to
will
the
contribute
future.
To nutrients to
wow.
the full the complete
We'd
cycle.
Love to see some more. Beautiful artwork.
This is a goddess figure. You can see the little mushroom there.
Yes.
There's a lot of been a lot of emphasis in the last few years on the reemergence of the goddess, or understanding more deeply what the feminine is, and so bringing it into balance, not one aspect dominating the other, but having
right.
balance. This is another sort of spirit guide figure.
Has your artwork been used anywhere?
Yes, it's appeared in different things, events mostly. So had a lot of artwork helping to create transformational environments and events. This one is kind of scary to some people. It's an extraterrestrial.
What you don't know is scary. That's beautiful.
Strange being. I don't know where they come from. You know, they just appear on the paper, and I say, "Oh, hi. Who are you?"
So, your friends, your family, people you met while you were living on H Street. If you had a net and you could catch 1, 2, 3 memories that you would love to share. Maybe you can tell us some of the names of people that were around that made differences with their art and their writing, or Ginsberg you mentioned, and a few maybe memories that you are left with, that if you can just grab 2, 3 memories, what would be the highest? What would be the ones that you can't forget?
Well, definitely one is sitting around the campfire in the morning when I was traveling with Alan and Gary, and we would all be either writing in our journals or reading Milarepa. And those days were pretty amazing journey. My time in Big Sur, living outside in at Esalen, birthing my babies, the birthing at home, the magnificent joy of bringing forth these children in a natural environment with people singing and flutes playing, the babies coming out, being received into community.
Right.
Very beautiful.
Beautiful.
Very beautiful.
And
the ceremonies over the years, many years of rituals and ceremonies, circles and drumming and singing with people, ceremonials.
Do you feel people want to be a community? People are drawn together and
oh, yes.
all want to give love and be loved.
Absolutely.
And that is a simple completion of
absolutely
of being here.
It's the greatest healing, I think, that we really need for this planet, is the recreation, the reweaving of community. And that's really why I got involved in conflict resolution. I was doing holistic healing work, and I was seeing people do a lot of emotional healing and coming to places of new awareness and understanding in their lives. But basically, they would still go back to a life of great isolation and separation. And I began to look at that, and I could see over and over that what really needed to happen for these people was to have community in their lives, to be living in community. So then I began to ask myself, what does it take to create community? And one of the main things that I saw to be able to have ways to work through conflicts creatively, to be able to come back to a place of harmony, because we have such a conflict phobia. We in our culture have a fear of conflict. We think there's something wrong if there's conflict. As
conflict is growth.
And it's growth, and it's an opportunity to come closer. So I began to focus on conflict resolution as a way to be able to contribute to rebuilding community in our culture. And
how do you help people heal from the past ideas and patterns and become who they really are?
of what I'm doing right now.
What advice, yes.
What I'm doing right now is teaching workshops, and I do trainings in nonviolent communication, and people do incredible deep healing in these. Just
is there any word of advice that you can put on camera?
always a big challenge to sum things up. And
it's totally.
Short.
But are there any key words? Are there any... start right now, or, you know, or... Do you see good in everything? Do you find the good in everything? I mean, that's a skill right there.
Yeah.
To be able to be open enough, to be that open.
To see each other as humans. Take the labels off of each other.
Right.
And see each other as human beings.
Yes.
To get away from labeling each other, whether it's role, label, boss, or...
Sure.
You know, even the label child is dehumanizing. To
sure.
really see each other as human beings.
As human beings, yes. Makes a lot of sense. I have one other memory I would love you to remember, the Oracle.
Yes.
Were you ever around when a new cover arrived out and was printed?
Sure.
Or,
yeah.
You know, when the writers got around? Is there one memory you can remember about
the
Oracle?
I remember
the
interview with Timothy and Alan and Gary Snyder. And that I was there for that. And that was very...
What part of the interview, do you remember the article? Do you remember anything about the interview?
Don't ask me anything specific about
right.
it.
It's been a long time, you know. But these are major people that affected change, and people listened to them. And since people listened to them, it was very powerful when articles came out in the Oracle.
Yes.
Because this was not the normal journalism.
Yes.
And it was...
Yeah. I think it was one of the main things that was influencing people. Also the dances. For me, going to the dances at the Fillmore was life-changing. It was as though we were being just burst open, you know, all
right.
of the old programming in the body, the uptightness.
Right.
I mean, just to be able to have that music blasting through us and opening up. So the visuals and the writing that was going on in the Oracle, and then the physical experience of being with the music and the dancing.
Sure.
It's another aspect of that opening where our minds were being open. It's a real unification of body, mind, and spirit that was going on.
Sure.
And so on all levels, we were being opened up.
Sure.
And it was pretty exciting, and
sure.
it still is. I still see the opening happening. What it looks to me like is that there was a wave that went through, and there were a whole section of the populace that received certain kinds of initiations through psychedelics, through experiences that were...
Through the music.
Many, through the music and the dancing and through the writing and so on. And now I see that wave spreading through the mainstream. It's certainly still going on. And the flower that bloomed then cast many seeds, and now those flowers
finally
are blooming. That's what I see.
As we close, that's part of what I wanted to ask you about is as you see now what's going on with young people, and as we see what you showed us, the circle events that happened at Bolinas and the future, you're hopeful?
I'm very hopeful. Even with cell phones.
There's a way to communicate.
And there are certain things that have given me a lot. For example, Frances Moore LePay's book that she wrote with her daughter. They traveled around the world and they documented things that are really changing the world, that are really working. If anybody wants to get a sense of hope, read that book. It's
what's it called again?
Hope's Edge.
And by?
By Frances Moore LePay. She wrote a little book, you may remember, Diet for a Small Planet.
Sure.
And this is an amazing book. Other things that give me hope, you know, standing in a field full of young people who are tree sitters and demonstrators trying to stop the cutting of the forest, dedicating their lives
sure.
to this and all oming together while there's a big rainbow in the sky. I mean, I see so many positive things going on. The synergistic connection of many peace movements across the planet. The connecting of the dots, the awareness that we have what it takes to create a culture of peace and a culture of abundance for everyone, this awakening that it is possible, and it's the awakening, to me, it's really exciting moment, just as exciting as it was back in the 60s.
Well, I want to just thank you so much for being part of this.
Thank you.
And those that are watching this in the future, personally, you aren't just one of the thousands of players. I can tell from your spirit. I can tell from your focus and the work you're doing now. You have such passion that is so catching that your contributions, whether you realize it or not, inspired by your art, but your vision of community and peace and making change is very powerful. And I just want to thank you so much for being here so we could document this. And we'll be asking you back later to partake some more.
Thank you.
And Martine, we are so pleased you are here. And thank you so much. Yeah.